Okay. Yeah, thanks for coming. So I will try to give you a short overview of what we are doing at the University of Luxembourg, and especially we are an interdisciplinary institute belonging to the university, but somehow aside and more a little bit of a speedboat for the university. That's the Luxembourg Center for Systems Biomedicine. We are in the south of Luxembourg, and you see there is a lot of steel stuff, so it was actually the biggest steel company in Europe. And we are on the same campus, and the interesting thing is that they left about 30 to 40% of the old steel stuff in between. So you have the new buildings, but still also the old buildings. So architectonically, it's quite an interesting area. And the LCSB is part of the Luxembourg Biohealth Initiative. We are still quite young, so we are founded in 2009, but we got our first building, the little white one down there, in 2011. And we are focusing on personalized medicine and specifically on neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson. Then we have four major centers, so to say. We have a clinical translational research center where we also have doctors actually employed who are also working at the hospitals. We have an experimental biology group and a technology platform group. They are developing also technology like gut on a chip and these kind of things where we can measure stuff. And then nearly half of the institute is computer science driven, so bioinformatics or computational biology. I'm heading the core facility. We have about 30 to 35 people. We are responsible for doing the data integration and management for all the in-house pipelining. So we do a lot of genomics analysis, also proteomics and imaging. We do that, looking at the data, network reconstructions. We do visualization tools, developments in 2D and 3D. We also apply a lot of text mining to full text corpora where we extract information, and then we are partner in a lot of international and European-wide projects, and two of them are the IMI project, eTwix and Agenomy, where also transmarters have used. There's a bigger picture from our compute center missing, so we have quite a substantial compute facility there with more than 5,000 cores, and we just got this week also one of these specific hardware chips, the Dragon chip, which is also a company here in San Diego, which gives us much more speed on the genome analysis. So you go down in principle to 20 minutes instead of many hours on a cluster system. In principle, what we want to do, what we want to understand is shown here, quite a lot of stuff here, but on the left side you in principle have your healthy system. You have all your cell types and organelles, and they are all happy. Then something happens, so you have a perturbation of the system by genomics or environmental or lifestyle factors, and then you have a perturbation in these systems, and that can be different dependent on the cell type you are in. And then we have another complication, that we have a time factor in there where we have minutes, days, sometimes many years if we talk about Alzheimer or Parkinson. And then, we have on the right side, we have the medical doctors, and they talk about diseases and symptoms. And in between, there's this area where the molecular biologist or the systems biomedicine people really don't understand what the doctor says, and the doctor don't understand really what we say. So we have a missing link here, and we try to get this close. And we think we need, in principle, then all the data types you hear also here in many talks. And we have to put in principle, the sum of all these data types over time to really understand what happens in the living system. And I will show you one project where we have started now in Luxembourg to really go into systems biomedicine. That's called NICER, for National Center for Excellence in Research for Parkinson. So that's an 8-year research program. It's a national program, and it brings the partners together. So the LCSB, where I'm working on, the Luxembourg Institute of Health, the Integrated Biobank, and the Central Hospital in Luxembourg. And the focus is again Parkinson's disease, and the goal is to set up a cohort of about 800 patients and look into biomarker signatures and improve the diagnosis and characterization of the conditions. So this is quite a big project. As I said, 8 years. Also, the patients, of course, are involved. from the day one. And what we do there is in principle, which is I think quite unique for our bioinformatics group, we took over the IT for the whole project from day one, and we didn't allow for any paperwork by the medical doctors, so everything is electronically from day one. So we started immediately in principle to set up this electronic clinical data capture system in REDCap. Then we have the data sample and collection site there. We have the biobanking doing all the analysis and then some more analytical labs, and we bring everything together in this reporting system. And then in principle, we go from there in our more research-oriented systems like the TransMart system and so on. You also see there mobile apps. So we have one app together with Sage Bio Networks, which is now, I think, in Europe, the first cohort where we can use this. Oops, I'm jumping. Well, maybe I go step by step. What we do is in principle get all these data together, we put them in TransMart, and then the hope is that we do analytics and we find out something more about the living system. We have the REDCap server set up. In Luxembourg, you have to do it also immediately in different languages. So in French, German, in English, and probably also now in Portuguese, because we have 15% Portuguese population in Luxembourg. This is used from day one. You see it's quite elaborate. We have 24 records and 1,800 fields. So if you have all the subtypes of Parkinson's, then you sit there for a few hours and answering. And it has all the typical tests medical doctors do, of course, in the clinics, the motor examination and all the other tests. I said we also have a so-called flying team, where in Luxembourg it's a driving team. Flying would be a little bit too much, where we have nurses which go to the patients if they can't come to the hospitals. So we enrolled in this Apple device enrollment program where you, in principle, get control over these iPads. So you control remotely what is installed on these iPads. The users who have this can't do anything except running this REDCap application in principle. And then there's a software also where you can wipe it, for example, if somebody would lose an iPad, and everything is encrypted on these devices, but even if somebody loses it, you can wipe it remotely. So that's quite safe, and people like it there because we like it because there's really no paper, even when people go to the patient at home. Then we have this Empower application on iPhones, which patients now use at home whenever they want, before medication, after medication, and what they do in principle, they have to tap with their fingers on certain buttons, and you can measure how accurate and how fast it is, and they also have to speak in there because you can detect on the tremor how well they are. Complication is again security and privacy, of course, and that just system is always hassle, because Empower requires that people register with their email nodes in the US with Sage Bio Networks, but we don't want to know in principle the email addresses, so we had to do also a pseudonymization service in between, which gives only the medical doctors an access to these data. This is an area which is increasing very fast, and we will see this more and more often, that people have devices at their house measuring certain things, and this is changing actually the whole data flow we also have typically in a bioinformatics department, where you typically get dead Excel files, but this is now really data coming in every day, every night, on a constant flux. I'm coming to that because I have to do another sidestep. In this IMI project, there was such a high demand for these curation and hosting services and TransMart things that we spun out a company, ITTM, so for IT, for translational medicine. And the nice thing for us is that we actually got in strategic investment by the Post Group of Luxembourg. So this is an old-fashioned post. But in Luxembourg, they run big data centers, and we are hosting the data in there, and they have, of course, as a big company also daughter companies, like this Intech companies, and they have a program where they have the sensor kit for medical applications. So they have also one where you have the sensors at the house of the patients. But this would be a system where the patient comes into the hospital, then the first 5 minutes he gets all kinds of sensors and measurements, and then when he sees the doctor, all kinds of stuff is already measured. And we are now exploring with this company how we set this up also for our Parkinson patients. So this is, not up to date, but last year, October, we had 19 data sets integrated also from studies with collaborations with German sites. And we are now about over 450 patients already, so it's faster than we expected in the beginning. And this is quite positive. I think there was no study done in Luxembourg so far, so this is the first one, and people really take it very positively. And these are then the other studies coming in. Everything is then collected in one system. What we have now is that we get all these data from the surroundings, so from patients, from the biobank, from the labs and so on. So we needed a central piece where all these data come together, even the mobile data, which I mentioned. So we have a tool now, which is in principle collecting all the data, where we can go into this dashboard and see who sent data overnight via the mobile applications, how many patients are in, at what visit, what is missing and so on. So this is a central information dashboard we have. And then we move a lot of these things then into the Transmart system, and you saw probably some of the Smart R things already, where we developed then all these interactive graphics modules. We are working now on time series. I think Adriano showed already a little bit. This is a mock-up of a new one, where you just select in your data in your time series, but then we also would like to show the soft measurements like sleepiness or headache or whatever the people have. And this is the first example also of the new timeline visualization, where you can then just add on different symptoms or different metadata people have measured. So this will come one of the next versions in Transmart then also. This is just a little a showcase, so to say, where we link now Transmart data with visual data and with genetic information. So on the top left, you would have a Transmart system. These are data coming from the Erasmus Center, and it's volumetric measurements of brain of Alzheimer patients and controlled patients. And then you see the distributions. And here you would see then the patient and the measurement of this volumetric measurements. And when you click on one specific patient, this one, then you also can get into the detailed measurement of all the volumetric measurements in each of these brain regions. In the middle, you see the brain connectivity, which was also measured by functional MRI. And here you see the open bell networks, which are attached to that patient in that brain region. So when you have a measurement, and this is a very little open bell network, of course there are bigger ones, then you can click actually on TP53, for example, and then you see the mutation pattern of that patient in that protein. Then you can go on, of course, further when you have more 3D animations of brain. So this is the first time also I saw that we can really match molecular data into these more high dimensional phenotypic descriptions like brain images and MRI scans. Okay, I'll just skip this. This is another development where Transmart also plays a role as the data repository. This is our Parkinson map. You can go there on this server, everything is public. There we have collected all the genes and proteins which were ever mentioned in literature with Parkinson's disease. And this is a hand-curated set. So you see the layout in principle, that you had the mitochondria and nucleus and so on in the cell, and then we map in principle all the proteins and genes on this map, and each node, so to say, is linked to databases where you can then get more information. You can do a search. You can also search for drugs. Here in the you see somebody typed in aspirin, and then you see all the targets where aspirin is binding to. What we also allow, this is the basic architecture, that you have your source data, so you have your data mining results, you have your SPMN compliant models, you also have dynamically handled data, experimental data like gene expression data also, and this we put then together into the system. And you saw probably when you know Google Maps, so this is a Google Maps API we use, so when you're familiar with Google Maps, you immediately can use this map here. We also have put this, because it's quite a big map already. We have this on a multi-touch screen now, a big one, where people can then explore the map, go into it and explore it. We attach now more screens to it that you can freeze some areas or some additional information and look at them in detail. And we have now actually the second one, so we are also linking these two systems that you could use remotely. One may be remote in the hospital and one in our institute, and then people can work together and explore and discuss different hypotheses on the system. So what we have implemented is also an overlay. So on the left side, you see the big map now, and there's a differential gene expression data compared by a post-mortem brain of a male Parkinson patient compared to control. And then you see these three different areas in more detail, where you see the over and under expression between the different between the patient and the control. So this allows you to compare different states. For example, in Parkinson, you always have aging as a process underlying. So we also have an aging map, and there you want to subtract in principle the aging processes from the Parkinson specific processes, which you can then identify and go into the details. This allows you also, this is again, it's all public, you can download your own instance. It allows you also to just go in into a sub area, write or make a rectangle or whatever that is, and then you can export your own little map and put it in Cell Designer or any tool which understands this as the VGN markup language. And then you can work on your own little map. We also allow people to interact with us. So we have datatons or hackathons or however you want to use it, where people can actually go into the map and then put comments in there and say this is not correct, or there's something missing, or that should be more refined. So this is then going to our curators, and we have currently about every 6 months a new update on the map where these comments are then taken into account and updated. What we also have done is this, you see very often that people can't stay always in Transmart. You have to get out of Transmart also and do something more. So we have linked the Transmart system to a Galaxy server, where we do, for example, a gene-rich enrichment analysis or more complicated stuff. Maybe sometimes you have to do also some high-performance applications, and that you can do then in your Galaxy pipeline. And then we link now the outcome of this analysis again to our disease maps, where we then can visualize a few things. So we have started now to map genomic information into this Parkinson map. So on the left side, you see subject. So these would be just a patient, where you have loaded then all the variant files of these patients. And then you go into the details and you see who has what kind of mutations and mutation pattern in these specific genes. This is quite interesting if you have to do family studies, where you can then group subfamilies and look how the patterns actually evolve in the family or pop up. Okay. Then we also have three groups actually in the institute. They work on the modeling part, so we open also the map now to the modeling area. In one of the next versions, we will be able to incorporate then model results into the map, so you will see then the time series of some fluxes people have measured or predicted or computed, but you also can go into other tools if you want to wish this. We have another group in our institute by Ines Thiele and Roland Fleming, and they have done this recon map, so the metabolite, the human metabolite map. So this is not anymore this Parkinson map I showed, these are now the metabolites of the human. And you see it's also quite big. There are a lot of metabolites in there, and we moved their implementation in principle now on the same technology we have with this PD map on the Google application. And in principle we have now two maps, one protein genes in principle, and now we are connecting these two maps, allowing them also to go to the metabolites. So if you look for biomarkers, sometimes it's also nicely to look what all these enzymes are actually doing. Also there we open it to the modeling, so here you could then put in flux information where you do some modeling or predictions. And I think I'm already finished. So you see here from the logos there are a lot of people involved, and I hope I could show you where we are going. So we really try to get the molecular stuff together with the clinical stuff and combine a lot of these tools and visualization things to have a tool in hand which tries, helps us to visualize the things and also then generate the next hypothesis steps for the next diagnostic tools or experiments we do in the lab. Thanks.